Hey everybody, it's Eric from Breakthrough Broker. Hope you're having an awesome July. And man, it's so awesome to see so many agents on a call that's not related to technology. I'm actually shocked. So hey everybody, as always with all our Breakthrough Broker webinars, please interact, ask questions, type in the question bar in the control panel. I will try to get to everything that I can today. If not, you can always email me at Eric, E-R-I-C, at breakthroughbroker.com. And again, it's awesome to see everybody on the call today, and can't wait to get this started. So, all in all, guys, this is really important to me. When Nathan and I were selling real estate, it used to drive him crazy when I would go to listing appointments, especially at some listings that we were really dying to get. And I would be at the listing appointment. By the way, guys, if there's any technical problems or there's audio problem, I'm not seeing any audio problems right now. If there's an audio problem, let me know. It might be on your end, but I'm not seeing any on my end at this point. But again, everybody, so back to my story. It used to drive Nathan absolutely crazy that I would go to a listing appointment with nothing. You know, Nathan had this huge listing presentation. And he'd print it out and he'd put it in their nice folder and all the stuff that he would like prepare for and practice for the listing presentations. And I literally would walk out of the office and go. And almost 99% of the time win those listing presentations. And I think the reason was that I had really embraced, says it's a little choppy. All right, I'm hearing from Lauren. Anyone here, am I okay with on audio on some ends? I'm having a few people say audio is a little choppy. Check your Wi-Fi on your end, but I think I'm doing okay here. So thanks, Chris. Thanks, Donna. So I really embraced early on, and part of that was from maybe being a police officer and police detective, was that I loved talking to people and I loved building rapport and basically making friends with my clients before they even decided to work with me. So almost 100% of my listing presentation was rapport. And I'm not kidding. You guys could call Nathan because we used to argue about it all the time. And so that's why this is important to me today, to really be talking about conversations. This industry and our world, like, come on, I have a 16-year-old and a 12-year-old. And my 16-year-old will text me and I'll call him immediately back and he won't answer. And it drives me absolutely crazy that my son, who's holding the phone when he's texting me, can't answer the phone when I call him back. I like to talk. It drives my children crazy. And so we're living in Snapchat and instant messaging and text messaging and email and this whole world of all this messaging. And you know, the focus in our industry too, these are webinars that I recently either received an invite to or been on. And I'm doing webinars on lead generation and CRM and sponsored posts and predictive text and big data and lead pages and Facebook pixels and you name it, all of this technology that we're mastering, that we're focusing on. And we really forget as a group that we won't win the business. We won't win that lead unless they like us. We have to meet our clients. We have to meet our clients at some point, correct? So, and when we're meeting our clients at some point, good. Thanks, guys. I'm just getting good audio reports on my end. Thanks. So, when we're meeting a client, I don't care how well you text with them, how good you emailed, and if they emailed you back and said, "We're going to use you," and you guys are hiding behind these messages and they meet you and hate you and you can't talk to them, they will not use you. They will use a realtor who can talk and have a conversation and who basically they like and trust. I'm going to share a story that spurred this class on and made me want to teach this to everybody and really add it to Breakthrough Broker's repertoire of what we're teaching throughout the country, because I do believe a renewed focus on some very basic conversation skills is needed in our industry because we're focusing on everything else under the sun. So it's pretty cool. I went into a Starbucks recently, like a month or two ago, and basically 2/3 of all the real estate agents in Denver were at that Starbucks. I swear, I don't know how that happens, but it was pretty cool. I overheard an amazing conversation. It was an abnormally long Starbucks line for the day, and it basically went like this. I had seen and learned later, a well-dressed realtor was meeting some new clients for the first time, and I saw her. She was standing behind me. She introduced herself. She gave the husband a firm handshake and the wife a short hug, and I heard her say, "It's great to finally meet you guys in person." I loved her enthusiasm. I was kind of smiling as I was standing in front of them. I sensed the apprehension from her prospective clients, both visibly in their body language and verbally. And I think that's normal when we're meeting strangers for the first time, right? Where everyone's a little apprehensive when they're meeting someone for the first time. But I think it's a little enhanced when the potential clients are trying to buy a home, which I discovered later in this conversation, and you're dealing with the largest financial purchase of their life. So I think that apprehension is even higher. And so, you know, as we're standing there, I heard the realtor behind me jump right in and she asked, "How are your kids? You know, I thought maybe you'd bring them today." And the new prospective clients went on this long response about where their kids were. So she asked a great question and they were talking about their kids and where they were that day. I think they were with an aunt or something, and they were talking about where the aunt was taking them, and she just listened. And it was really cool. She followed that up with, "I never asked you, do they play any sports?" And we're still standing there in line and I'm smiling. And the dad gave a very long, proud response and talked about all their kids' sports accomplishments and everything they've achieved and their trophies and the tournaments they've won. It appeared as if they were a little concerned about youth sports with their move. So I heard the realtor behind me say, "Awesome. My son's in baseball. My daughter's in gymnastics. I have a ton of youth sports connections down here. I'll get you in front of some people as soon as possible." So right then and there, I noticed literally, physically, after that banter, and I was getting closer to order, that there was a relaxation from the prospective clients. I saw their rigid, erect posture start to ease up a little bit. So then I went ahead, I got up to the front, I ordered my vanilla soy latte and my daughter's like 2,000 calorie frappuccino. She was waiting outside for me. And she kept going. And so she started asking them more questions. And they were kind of laughing. And she had asked, "Are you liking your new company?" And he started talking about how much he loved Denver and the weather and all of those things. And she followed up by saying, "Have you ever been to Red Rocks?" And said, "If the weather's great next weekend, I'm going to take you there. You'll love it." I went, I got my stuff. I was putting sugar and doctoring up my coffee, and I watched them walk out. And the couple was smiling and laughing, and their rigid posture was gone. They were going to look at houses. This realtor just made a connection, a client for life. Now, I don't care how great the technology is. We've all stood there and met new clients for the first time and had it be a fail and had it really not have that component that I heard. And I love this conversation so much that I wanted to, so I'm still getting, guys, I hope the audio quality is good. We're recording this, so if you're having bad audio quality on your side, hopefully you can get the recording, but I'm gonna keep rocking and rolling, because I'm only getting a few reports. If you have poor audio quality, check your Wi-Fi connection. So I'm going to keep going. So again, she made a client for life, and I loved watching and listening to this. It made me so proud of our profession. It made me really proud of what we do, and invigorated me about how we can do business and affect people's lives. So, you know, why is rapport important? I think with the increased competition in this industry, that old cliche of know, like, and trust is more important than it's ever been. There's so much competition in every marketplace. Everybody knows 10 real estate agents, especially as this market's gotten better. More people have gotten in this industry, and it's harder and harder to get more and more business. So being great at rapport is more important. I think good rapport, as I talk to you in the story, really relaxes the client. And if the client's interviewing multiple buyer's agents or multiple listing agents, that relaxation can build trust and really get into their subconscious mind and begin to accept you, your ideas, and your suggestions. So that's why that rapport starts to really come into play. And I think now, in addition to developing some great technology skills and marketing skills, a good conversation skill set is as important to getting the business as anything else. More important than your presentation, more important than anything you bring with you physically is that conversation skill set, and it's not being taught right now. So for those brokers on this call, for those managers and trainers on this call, start thinking about teaching your agents this kind of stuff, in addition to all the buzzwords that we're hearing in the industry that make me kind of want to throw up sometimes. Sorry. I think we start to get this conversation and basically rapport, the first couple minutes of that conversation is the root of effective communication. And without this, no one's really going to listen to your message. So what I wanted to talk to you guys today about, and again, I'm so excited to have so many realtors on a call that's not technology related. You made my week. I think the most important thing, I'm going to bring to you guys 10 concepts that I used that I wanted to share, that I also researched out there, that I think can help you guys with that amazing rapport. So we're going to start with, and this is pretty common sense, but really highlight a common interest. What did she highlight when she was talking to those brand new clients in the Starbucks line right off the bat? She asked about the children. They both had children that played sports. That was the first common interest. Now, I would bet you, I bet money that this real estate agent did some stalking. And what better stalking in this day and age than social media, right, guys? I mean, I used to do my stalking, my highlight and common interest while I was walking up to the house on a listing presentation. Maybe I'd interview the referral source, but I'd walk up to the house and I'd see a hockey net in the driveway and some street hockey sticks. And I'd know right off the bat I'd get that business because I played hockey growing up. I'm a huge hockey fan and we could talk about hockey for 3 hours. Or a basketball in the driveway. Or walk in and see a dance bag because my daughter was in dance. So all of these things you can do now before the meeting by just looking on Facebook to see who you're meeting with. Check out Instagram, see what kind of pictures they're doing. See if they went on a vacation. If they recently just got back from Hawaii and Hawaii is your favorite vacation destination, you have a common interest that helps build that rapport. So Facebook, Instagram, and you can LinkedIn, look at their LinkedIn profile. You will find something that you can highlight during the first 2 minutes of that conversation that will instantaneously start that rapport process and get them to really love you right off the bat. This is something that we do little of that I would love to see you guys do more. Interview your referral source. Now, we still sell business a lot, mostly the same old way by referral. Your neighbor, your friend, your family. If somebody refers you to a colleague at work, ask the referrer about that person. Do a little interview. Nathan and I did referral interviews. When someone called and said, hey, my sister's moving out from St. Louis, looking for a place in Fort Collins. Can you give them a call? I'd say, sure, tell me more about them. What do they do in St. Louis? Why are they moving out? Is it a business transfer? Do they have children? Do they like sports? Do they like beer? We had a lot of breweries in Fort Collins. So all of those things I'd ask so that I could really understand who I was talking to and build that rapport right from the beginning. So don't feel weird doing some research up front. We'll call it research and not stalking. And understanding what they've been doing, where they are, so you can find a common interest right off the bat. Number two, be genuine. You know, that's the one thing, another one thing that I feel is really important. Rookie realtors, just like rookie cops, when I was teaching rookie cops, you try to take on a persona that might not be yours because you think that's what the potential clients want. Maybe that client is a tech guy or girl. Maybe that client is in sales and you take on a persona that you think they're gonna like. And I learned really early on that this is your quickest way to fail. You know, I tried really hard. We worked with a lot of engineers in Northern Colorado. There was actually a big tech industry. And we worked with a lot of computer engineers and different kind of engineers. And I'm kind of the spiky haired, fast talkative guy. And I tried to change when I was in front of the engineers, and it always went bad. So I figured, you know, they're either gonna like me or not like me, but I'm gonna be me. And don't take on a sales persona. Don't take on a persona of what you think they're gonna want. You have to be you for this to work, for you to build rapport, for you to build a relationship. Not everyone's gonna wanna work with you. It happens. It always drove me crazy when it happens, but it happens. And so don't change yourself. Don't take on another persona. Smile, relax, let it happen as normally as you can, even if you're nervous. Number three, listen. No, I mean really listen. And I'm not talking like wait to talk, because you know those people. Like I used to be one of them. You're hearing them and they're talking, but you're formulating what you're going to say next. You're formulating your story because you want to jump in and show them how big an expert you are in the industry and how great you are as an amazing realtor. And we know you are, but you're not listening. You're just hearing a voice and you're waiting to talk. And that's one of the biggest fails in creating rapport and developing conversations with people, is that you're waiting to talk rather than listening. And that was hard for me to really get good at, was that listening. And I started by biting my lip, like literally physically doing some things. For those of you on the call that know me, you're probably smiling. Like literally biting my lip. And when I go on meetings with Nathan, he kicked me under the table. But really listen and make sure you're part of that conversation. Don't wait to talk. And be aware and practice this with your kids, with your spouse, with your clients, with your partners. It's really important. And you can do this by listening and repeating important statements that they're making. You know, if they say, you know, I hated the winters in Denver, so I just decided to move to Scottsdale because the winters in Denver were so bad. Most of you on the call are like, man, the winters in Denver are not so bad. But, you know, you might say, great. So yeah, the winters in Denver could be pretty cold. You know, so you're repeating what they're saying so they see that you're actually listening and hearing them. And even more important, demonstrate understanding. What do I mean by demonstrate understanding? Actually say, yeah, you know, I was watching last winter and I saw that they had like 7 days of below zero weather. I can understand why you might want to move here. You just demonstrated that you understood that 7 days of below zero weather, super cold. You were listening to them because they told you they didn't like the cold anymore, and that's why they're moving to Scottsdale. So that's all really important on that listening side of things, is to don't wait to talk, actually listen. Guys, if you're into self-improvement, there's tons of books out there that can help you, kind of talk you through that. And again, that was something I really had to learn to get good at, was that listening side of things. Number four, slow down. And I put in bold there, that was hard for me. And so really hard for me. Again, those of you that know me, that have seen me speak or met me personally, you're probably sitting there smiling, saying, I bet. Super hard for me. And so this also took practice. Why slow down? When you pause in the first couple minutes of speaking and you speak a little slower, a stranger who's never met you before, this will create a little higher credibility in what you're saying. Fast talk, fast speech, you know, can kind of be you know, looked at as a fast talking salesman. And you want to build rapport, and building rapport is know, like, and trust. And someone's going to know, like, and trust you if you slow down a little bit, pause a little bit when you're speaking, listen, let it sink in. You don't have to respond instantaneously. Take 2 or 2 seconds and then respond. And so that slowdown super, super, super important on that end when you're looking at that stuff. Hang on one second, guys. I want to make sure I'm still with y'all. Good. Those of you asking for copies, yes, you can get copies and also a recording. I'm going to keep going. Next step, ask questions. In my story, when I was listening to this realtor, she was a rock star at asking questions. Now, sales training 101 would say, let the other person speak more than you. Well, rapport building 101 should also say, let the other person speak more than you. What does that do? It creates comfort on their end. When they hear their voice more than your voice, they become comfortable with it. They hear their voice every day. So ask great questions. When I was listening to this conversation, I loved hearing the questions that she was asking. She was asking some great questions. How are the kids? Where are they today? I thought you'd bring them. How is your new job? Are you liking it? How are your coworkers? How's Denver? What do you think of the weather? Have you been to Red Rocks? All of those things are spurring on them talking. And the more they spoke, the more relaxed they got. The more relaxed they got, the closer they all became, and it was all working. So the questions are important. I think you can have these questions on anything that they're talking about. How was your day yesterday? Where did you go? Why did you go there for dinner? All these things can really be asked and then listen, right? What's great about asking questions, guys, is if the conversation continues to move along and is going well, then as you're asking questions and they're responding and you're listening, guess what you can formulate? Additional common interests. Oh man, we went to that restaurant like 3 weeks ago. We also thought it was pretty amazing. Little high price, but it was great. So again, ask a lot of questions during this conversation so you guys are able to formulate that relationship further and further. Number six, non-threatening boundaries. This is interesting. Non-threatening boundaries is something that I actually read about, and I love the idea. When the human, it's human nature to go into a conversation with a stranger feeling a threat level, kind of fight or flight. And we instantaneously walk into that new conversation when we're meeting somebody for the first time at a higher threat level. So if you were to tell them that you only had 20 minutes to meet, that gives them an out, which allays that threat, which makes them feel more comfortable. So establish an end time to the conversation. When you call them, when you make the appointment, hey, say, I only got 20 minutes, and reiterate that when you get there. Hey guys, I'm so happy to meet you guys. I'm sorry we only have 20 minutes. I have to get to this next appointment. Or I'm sorry we only have 20 minutes. We have to get going to see these five houses because they're all scheduled. Make sure that you set these boundaries that set you up for success early on. So the non-threatening boundaries, when I learned this, I started incorporating this recently into my rapport building. I didn't do it when I was a realtor, and I wish I did, but I think it's super helpful to say, hey, I think it's going to be great meeting you, but I really only have 20 minutes. I have to get to another meeting across town, or I have to get my kids to a game. So really, it gives them comfort that there's an end in sight to this meeting with a stranger. Number seven, storytelling. Now, I've done classes on storytelling for this group. I think we have some articles on Breakthrough Broker on storytelling. Obviously, I'm a fan. I told you a story at the beginning. I might tell you a story at the end, but storytelling is another great way to build trust effectively. You can build credibility by telling a story. It can entertain. So it's really that ability to tell a story, tell a piece of your. You're also giving a piece of your life away when you tell a story, You're telling them something about you, and it brings that comfort level higher and that threat level down when you're able to effectively tell someone a story as you're talking to them. So storytelling is number 7 on my 10 common concepts to build great rapport. Get good at it. Read some books about storytelling. Start telling stories. It really helps with that rapport. This was really hard for me as well. Number 8, match style. What do I mean by match style? This was tough for me when I was really trying to get good at this. There are people out there that don't like to talk. Oddly enough to me, it was hard because when you get that straight to the point person and rapport building is not working, you have to be more shortened to the point. You've all sat down with people that are like, all right, tell me what you got. And there's zero rapport. Now, I would argue, circle back around and keep trying to build more rapport a little bit. But you have to cut your rapport building shorter if, I'm just checking my audio settings here, if that person, you get that feeling right off the bat that they're one of these kind of people, you have to adjust. And I really, really had to make this work for me because I was failing. I was trying to get people who didn't, who just wanted to get right down to business. I was trying to get this friendship started, and they wanted nothing to do with it. So you have to be able to adjust at the beginning based on what you're seeing. And you'll probably know based on the communications before the meeting that they're short to the point and business oriented. So you know there still has to be some rapport, but it can also be short to the point, concise, and ready to rock and roll. Number 9 is a little controversial. I brought this up. And it's funny, guys. I would dress for the occasion. I would profile my customer before I go. When I showed houses to the police officers I worked with, they did not want me to show up in a 3-piece suit or even a tie. It was uncomfortable. As a matter of fact, I showed up at an open house in shorts and a polo with my clients who were happy with me. And the realtor holding the open house looked at me and said, Eric, thanks for holding up the profession. And very, very condescending. Now, I'm sure of the hundreds of agents on this call, some will agree with that realtor and some will agree with me. But for me, it helped create better rapport if I was able to try and mirror my client. And it's hard when you've never been there before. But if you work with a lot of cops, you know that they're in uniform all week and they're not going to be dressed up when you meet them in the evening or on Saturday. When I worked with surgeons and I picked them up from the hospital on their recruiting trips, yes, I would wear a tie. And sometimes it didn't go great because a lot of surgeons don't dress up. They don't like to. So, you know, to be honest with you, again, this to me, this is controversial. I've been called out on this a few times. But it works for me. You guys do what you want to do. But when you show up in a 3-piece suit and you're showing some people moving to the beach who love to surf, it's going to be tough to build that rapport. And again, this could be, you know, you guys can, you're more than welcome to disagree with me. I love that. I think you guys should do what you want to do. I'm just telling you, it helped me to be able to profile my clients based on my past interactions with like individuals from like backgrounds, and I was able to establish rapport better by kind of being dressed how they were dressed. The next thing is, and I think it's, you know you're here when you get this. When you're able to balance rapport with business, you've arrived. And there's a very fine line between going too far in that rapport conversation where they're starting to get bored and wondering, when are we going to talk about what we're here for? Or cutting it too short and not establishing that level of trust and friendship that you need to when building great rapport. And honestly, this is something that comes over time. It's something that you will learn by reading body language, by reading verbal cues. But when you've arrived and you know the exact time, because it changes with every single conversation, you will know that you're a rapport master when your internal intuition says, awesome, it was great talking about the kids. Now let's get down to business. Show me the house. What are some of the upgrades you made? Show me your favorite part of the house. What are the buyers going to love about this? Then you've made it. When you've created that know, like, and trust, and it's the perfect moment to start into your business conversation, that's when you're a master of building rapport. I'm going to close with a quick story and then try to answer some questions. But so we were doing some online shopping for cars, okay? Yeah, so Eric says three-piece suit in Phoenix, not going to happen. Eric, I was in Phoenix last week, and I had a couple hours before I went to the airport, and my night guard, because I sleep with this thing in my mouth so I don't grind my teeth, melted in the back of my car. So yeah, I get it in Phoenix. Okay, guys, so my wife and I were searching for cars. Online search. They have online salespeople now, right? A lot like searching for a home. And so I found two different dealerships that I wanted to go look at. And we went. By the way, it's the worst car I ever bought. I won't tell you what it was. But we go to the first dealership and we walk right in. And I actually had my wife and both kids with me. We walk into the dealership and the guy sits down right away and wants to start looking at the car, talking at the cars. He was talking super fast. It was uncomfortable. And we literally didn't even test drive a car. We looked in the showroom and we walked out. Right away, I knew I wanted to go talk to the other guy we had been emailing back and forth with. We went to the second showroom and the online sales guy who we'd been emailing back and forth came out. He shook my hand but looked at my son who was in his Taekwondo stuff and said, "Taekwondo, awesome," and gave my son a high five. He said, "I do Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. It's pretty cool." And they started bantering back and forth a little bit about it. And then we went to sit down. We actually started talking. My wife's from Costa Rica. And he said, "I hear your accent. Where are you from?" She says, "Costa Rica." He says, "Oh my gosh. We went there for our honeymoon. We loved it." So we talked about Tamarindo and all these places in Costa Rica. We didn't talk about cars for 40 minutes. And he was my favorite car salesman I ever dealt with. Besides the car we bought, I'd use him anytime. He was a master. So it absolutely makes a difference. The first guy lost a commission because he couldn't hold the conversation to gain my like and trust. The second guy has my business forever, especially if you go work for a different car dealership. And so honestly, guys, I think if you can get good at this, if you can focus on this a little bit, it will help your business. I hope this was helpful. I hope this was a helpful webinar for everybody. The new breakthroughbroker.com is out. So if you guys haven't seen breakthroughbroker.com, it's new. It's awesome. Check it out. We have tons of new content coming out. And hope everyone has a great rest of the month. We'll talk to you all in August. Have a great day. Thanks for coming, everybody.